Boa tarde, obrigado aos que estão presentes. Enfim, passam 10 minutos da hora. Se entretanto chegar mais alguém, eu depois darei a autorização de entrada. Hoje temos connosco um convidado especial. É a segunda sessão sobre envolvendo as Filipinas e Sudeste Asiático que temos em sessões deste tipo, na linha temática do CHAM, sobre a Ásia, povos, poderes e intercâmbios. Hoje temos connosco o Cuauhtémoc Villamar, que é um diplomata natural do México, de carreira, atualmente reformado. Serviu no Ministério dos Negócios Estrangeiros do seu país durante aproximadamente 3 décadas, nomeadamente na China, em Singapura, na Tailândia, no Canadá. Fez depois o doutoramento em História na National University of Singapore, em Singapura. E está hoje connosco porque lançou recentemente, já neste ano de 2021, o seu livro chamado Portuguese Merchants in the Manila Galleon System, 1565-1600, Routledge. O qual esteve várias vezes em Portugal, contactou com vários investigadores do CHAM, eu conheci-o há cerca de 3, 4 anos, quando ele ia lá fazer as suas pesquisas. E reencontrei-o agora há poucos dias na Conference Contacts and Continuities, que está a ser organizada, que está a correr ainda, pela Ateneo de Manila University, em colaboração com o CHAM. Foi um dos participantes há poucos dias. Hoje vem-nos apresentar uma comunicação, um paper chamado Informal Merchant Networks in the Manila Galleon System, 1565-1600. Portanto, dá-lhe a palavra. Primeiro, passava a palavra à Elsa Penalva, se quisesse acrescentar mais alguma informação. Elsa.
Ok, sorry. Peço desculpa. Sorry. Ok. Thank you very much. Muito obrigada. Eu peço desculpa. I apologize, but I have to read. A book has its own path. Portuguese merchant in the Manila Galleon system of Cuauhtémoc Villamar, it is already imperative for those studying the Portuguese presence in Asia, for the methodology and structure, and for the questions behind it. I made others regarding Macau merchants and Macau-Manila axis, but only because I departed from Macau. Let's keep working and the future will be new. Thank you, Cuauhtémoc. Please continue.
Obrigado, doutora Elsa. É uma honra para mim poder falar com uma equipe de pesquisadores dos mais alto nível. Esta é a segunda vez que eu contato com o CHAM, embora a primeira tenha sido 5, 4 anos. Uhum. Primeiramente com Paulo Pinto, que amavelmente me deu informação and guidance. Agora vou mudar para inglês para fazer a apresentação.
Uhum.
I share screen. Can you please enable the screen sharing?
Yes, you have authorization to share screen.
Very well. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. The topic today is informal merchant networks in the Manila Galleon system, 1565-1600, and I would like to dedicate the time mostly to the research element of my thesis for the PhD, more than the specific of the book. It's not exactly a book presentation, but a discussion with colleagues that are far more informed and better prepared than me in terms of the Portuguese expansion in Asia. But I want to show, first of all, the characteristics of the Manila Galleon system and how I arrived to this term of system. And the other is the presentation of the specific informal group of Portuguese merchants that were participating in the initial times of the Manila Galleon system at the end of the 16th century. The research found in different archives a network of 83 merchants of Portuguese origin that were involved directly or indirectly with the Manila Galleon. And the most interesting part is that they were at the beginning of the Manila Galleon system. So they have something to say about the structure of the system, something to say about the mechanisms, and they managed to modulate in certain way the Manila Galleon as a trading mechanism. This is a little known group of participants in the trade, but it is substantial, essentially because they carried the connections from Europe, because they came from a long tradition of trading during the foundation of Manila, 1571. Basically, the Portuguese already have half century, 50 years before, trading in Southeast Asia and in China. The interesting part also is the connection that they previously had with Europe and other parts of Asia, but how with the Manila Galleon, they also click the connection with the Portuguese merchants and others in the Americas. So they were crucial for the establishment of this type of trade. This community had a very specific and peculiar condition, characteristic, that is, they were Portuguese, they were new Christians, that means Roman Catholics of, in this case, new Jew in origin, but they were also abiding for the Roman Catholic religion. Not all the members of this group declared themselves as new Christians because it was not a condition to be popularized. It was just the way to move around. Some of them declared constantly the religion faith and trying to avoid the idea that they were converse people from the Jew origin. The research itself had the advantage of looking at the Philippines as the starting point, the vantage point. And in a way, the research started in Mexico, but the narrative of the research started in Southeast Asia. And this is a counterfactual, this is an element that is different, because normally the Manila Galleon start always with the idea of the traveling from Acapulco to Cebu in 1565, and then the discovery of the route going back from Asia to Acapulco. Instead here, the idea was to try to study the process in which the Manila Galleon had a route in Southeast Asia. And this is one of the elements that are relatively different in terms of the common narrative of the Manila Galleon. Just to refresh to you, but you know very well this information, the Manila Galleon was mostly dominated by the Spanish monarchy, carrying merchandise from Asia to the Americas and from the Americas to Asia for almost 250 years, from 1565. Can be arbitrary to say that since the first travel of Legazpi to Cebu, everything started. In reality, it started one decade later. But 1655, the Galeón San Pedro going to Acapulco, for the first time traveling that way, can be considered part of the Manila Galleon in general terms. The end of the Manila Galleon coincides with the independence of Mexico in 1815, in which it was impossible to continue the trade. In geostrategical terms, the Pacific Basin was called for a long time the Spanish Lake, but this is a bit an exaggeration because permanently there were intruders, let's say, using the imperial language. And the idea is that the Spanish tried to control all the ports, strategic ports in the Pacific, and they invest quite a lot in terms of security. Also in historical terms, this long period of the Manila Galleon coincides with two important elements, that is the end of the Ming Dynasty, the latest, let's say, 80 years of the Ming Dynasty, and the rupture, the change to the new dynasty, the Qing Dynasty, from 1644 on all the way to the 19th century. I repeat here the idea that in general terms, the arrival of Legazpi to Cebu was considered, let's say, the beginning of the process. But I think the most important element here is that the establishment of rules and regulations in 1593, in which then the crown agree to establish a set of norms, regulations to carry the trade. And this can be really technically the establishment of the Manila Galleon trade. For the purpose of analysis, it's more important to study these dates in the long term, in a continuum that started precisely half century before with the presence of the Portuguese in Malacca, 1511, and then the establishment of Macau around 1557. This is a part of the process, but in the long run, there are so many other elements that can clarify the idea of a continuum in which the establishment of rules and regulations in 1593 was the peak of a long process of communication. Important to say that the end of this study is 1600. That is arbitrary, but it's a way to cut to the study. But the presence of Portuguese merchants continue insistingly in a high level all the way the independence of Portugal in 1640. And interesting to see how it was connected that with the crisis in China. I will continue explaining this element. So system is necessary to insist in this element because the system implies a mechanism in the middle of the complex system, complexity of the reality of trade with so many parts, the systems indicate that there is a group of participants from different origins that agree in certain way of dealing with trade in the common benefit and with a purpose. In this case, the exchange of goods and people and ideas through the Manila Galleon, that it was invigilated and put in practice by the empire. So it's a system that has many participants, has many interests, but all of them reach a commonality in the benefit of all of them, and the participants are located in different places. I mentioned already this question of the union of the crowns from 1580 1600 1640 that is important, that is determinant also for the stability of the permanence presence of the Portuguese in the Pacific. So this was an opportunity used by the most advantaged traders that were, in this case, Portuguese, and in this case, New Christians, and they were in Southeast Asia for longer time than the Spaniards. So focusing in Southeast Asia, it's important because the existence of so many different sources of merchandise from Siam, Vietnam, Champa, Indonesia, and other places, China, Japan, etc., allowed the Manila Galleon to have enough steam in terms of trade that can match with the supply of silver from America. And this was possible, of course, through the innovation to the capacity of the traders to find alternatives to trade, to understand the necessities of a trade that is a long distance, a really long distance. And in many cases, the customers are in the other side of the world. They don't know necessarily the taste of the consumers, but in a trial error practice, they fine-tune the way of trade. And this was a characteristic of this specific period that the Portuguese merchants, I must insist, were the most advanced in that level. This is a repetition of the idea of how the mutually accepted protocols of trade was important, formal or informal, and they abide to these rules, and they continue using their ways of trading, but they were integrated in a hierarchical structure in the Manila Galleon. So with this regulations that were created in 1593 called permisión, an old Spanish language that is a regulation, happened that we can find already the input of some of the merchants of the Portuguese origin living in Manila and participating in the discussion in the name of the Manilenses of the Manila, but they were Portuguese, and trying to induce the formulation of norms and regulations that lately were approved in 1593 by the Crown. It's important, it's relevant that the conceal the maturity of this system of trade arriving in 1583, but there were many changes over time, over centuries. 250 years is enough time to make changes. But there are three elements that are essential for the participants, the stakeholders of this trade, is the legality of transactions. It was a perfect norm of weight of the merchandise, the quality, the amount of money that each of traders can invest in the ship, and vice versa, how much silver can be they can bring from the Americas, in this case, legally from New Spain, illegally from Peru, but it's silver that came from the Americas. The predictability of transport, that is something that has been discussed and is more and more clear how that is determinant for the trade particularly at that time, the currents, the seasons, the periods of transportation. Not every month they can travel, only twice a year. And the other element is basically the security, because predictability of transport, yes, if there is rainy season, they cannot travel, the wind, etc. But also the appearance since the end of the 1600 of menaces from other traders, mostly Dutch and English. So the question posed since the beginning, how minorities foreigners can interrelate with this system that is so particular, so dominated by an empire? Well, mostly because the knowledge, the advanced knowledge of these merchants, that they were able to cooperate with the newcomers, in this case, Spaniards. And talking about Spaniards, the wide variety of Spaniards. Spain as such didn't exist as we know, but were different kingdoms and people from different places, including from other parts of Europe, while they abide the rules of religion. So it was a practical cooperation in an axis that goes from Macau to Manila. I will just mention quickly these core concepts that were determinant also for the definition of the group of merchants and can be applied to different groups of merchants as networks. Basically, that they were foreigners living permanently in another place of the world, that they were a diaspora as defined by Philip Curtin. It was a cross-cultural trade. Important in this sense is the fact that they were able to manage to deal with different languages, different ways of culture, different religions. Dr. Paulo Pinto knows very well and described very well the variety of markets that existed, for example, in Malacca. And they work as networks because in many occasions, the traders were connected without knowing each other. So they trust each other. They knew how to punish somebody that didn't follow the rules, separating the person, for example, from the network. And this is a mechanism that is quite well explained in terms of complexity and network. The merchant network, the networks of merchants is like the nerves of in a system like the body, or the cables in an electric system. The Portuguese, I insist, were very aware of the situation. Real practical situation of Southeast Asia, long time, half century before the Spaniards. And they understood, for example, the ability, the necessity to respect certain rules of the different religions, the Buddhism or the disciplines or ideological ways of life, cultural ways of life, like the Buddhists, the Muslims, or the order that the Chinese have in terms of the trade and how they consider the merchants in the lower level. And all of this was part of the knowledge, common knowledge of the Portuguese merchants already at the end of the 16th century. Of course, it was a level of conflict, rivalry between Macau and Manila. And that was expressed in different ways, including the reorganization of Macau, including the acceleration of the presence of religious organizations and structure in Macau in order to protect Macau from the competition of Manila. in any of the waste. Those are the routes of a trade. This is not my map, but is one of the most accurate ways of communication inside of Southeast Asia, originally developed by the locals, but used by the different merchants from abroad, primarily by Portuguese, and later on in the 17th century, by the Spaniards themselves going from Manila to different places. You can see the spices were the original engine, the original attraction to go to Southeast Asia, but quickly became China and Japan the most important or most attractive places for trading. And then the rest of Southeast Asia and India as part of this feeding system of trade. I insist in certain characteristics of the merchants, in this case, merchant networks, that is the ability of to develop an ars mercatoria, an ability or a set of the abilities, skills that they develop for a long, long time. This is the case, for example, the wide expansion of the networks, the religious identity. So they became Roman Catholics, even being Jew, and they insisted in that idea of being Roman Catholic in opposition and to other players that later on came, like the Dutch and the English. And in among the trading skills that were European and that were used in Southeast Asia is the ownership of transportation that they develop, and they innovate in several forms. They use different types of transportation, not the European transportation, to move from one part to another in Southeast Asia. Also to collect information, trading, intelligence in terms of trading, where are the best products, what are the seasons, who are the sellers, and which are the best possibilities to engage in this kind of trade in different places. So they need to be polyphasetic, able to deal with people in different languages, in different places, in different ways. They had a clear-cut ability of correspondence in the long distance. So they were extremely accurate in terms of sending letters from to Africa, to India, to Japan, to China, to Europe or the Americas constantly in order to know the prices and the market opportunities everywhere. So it was, even with the distances and the time travel, they had the ability to understand the difference of prices of cotton, silk, or any other merchandise in different parts of the world. This is, to me, something really amazing. I discovered that one of the main characters that I studied in detail was perfectly able to use the double entry system of accounting. And this is an advanced mechanism, advanced system created in Florence and Venice. But for them, it was part of the daily life, the double accounting. To enter into a small detail, but it was important in the testament of one of these merchants. He explained specifically how to deal with his accounting and telling the people to not mix the numbers, not separate the debit and credit. It should be in two columns, and they need to evaluate, because this is the question of timing. Sometimes the return of an investment took five, say six more years, but they were able to account in this way perfectly as if they were in any other place of the world, but they were in Manila or they were in Macau or Malacca. To secure their trade, they basically work in high-end merchandise. And this is an experience that probably they developed from the north of Africa when they were expelled from Portugal in 1492. And they were able to change their personality, trading personality, and start carrying products that were high value, not difficult to trade and to move. Of course, jewelry and spices and ostrich eggs or any other kind of high-end product that can be accepted in certain places all along the areas in which they move. They hold financial huge financial resources to deal with eventualities, to deal with difficult situations. Even we can consider the possibility to escape in case of prosecution of a war, etc. The negotiation skills are also very important, and I am talking a little bit in ahead when I am going to talk about one of the merchants of Macau that was important, was determinant for the connection Macau-Manila, that the description is this merchant, Bartolomé Vaz Landeiro, moved in Macau under an umbrella, big umbrella, and 80 soldiers in the small Macau in order to show off their richness, his ability to be like the king, even if he was a merchant. He was even nicknamed as the king of the Portuguese in Macau. He was not. But this is the art of representation of the Baroque, something that I continue studying in another area. So this ability of the merchants to deal with different cultures, different ways of obtaining the benefits through negotiation. And of course, risk management. That is another characteristic that is inherited from the Portuguese to the Spaniards in terms of procuring the service in case of the breakage of a ship, or fire, or other possibilities. And this is a part of the elements of the Misericordia Cofradía, Misericordia Brotherhood, in which is religious, but at the same time is a kind of insurance company, communal, to protect the merchants in different places. And this was inherited, implanted in Manila, almost immediately transferred from its know-how, transferred from the Portuguese all the way to Manila. It's specifically the case, the first Misericordia Brotherhood was created in Malate, near the seaside, but outside the city. And they create the first brotherhood in that case. So the Portuguese in that I started studying, and I go back to the idea of why I started studying them, because most of the information is in the Mexican archives. And I was searching many years ago about the trading of the Manila Galleon in general, but I found this oddity, Portuguese merchants in the Mexican archives. And in this specific case, particularly Diego Fernandez Victoria, that in Spanish is Diego Hernandez Victoria, had a trial of the Inquisition and is a file of more than 1,000 pages, in which incredible is the testament, the will that he wrote perhaps 7 days before dying, and 7 days before the Inquisition took his place. So all the package of information, all the letters, everything is in a file in the Inquisition in Mexico. This is why it started in Mexico, but the story here started in Southeast Asia. And the connections lead me to Bartolomé Báez Landero, that in Manila was called Bartolomé Báez Landero. Bartolomé Báez Landero in Macao was this guy, an entourage of soldiers, servants, and moving in Macao like a king. He was the first merchant that supported the connection between Macao and Manila. That it was on occasion of the visit of Father Jose, I forgot in this moment, the ambassador of the governor of Manila, that went to Macao to announce the takeover, the crown of Philip II as Philip I in Portugal. The news already had arrived in Macao, but this embassy, this way of announcing the Portuguese, now we have a common king, was a political movement that the people of Manila used in order to try to control the whole region, particularly Macao. The people in Macao react in different ways, but Bartolomé Báez Landero understood this was a window of opportunity, and immediately sent a ship in order to send back the delegation, and also had other opportunities to support Manila and to show the ability to support Manila in the difficult times of fires and attacks, etc. Báez Landero was always willing to help. And at the end of his life, he brought to the crown saying, I am a good friend of Manila, of the Manilenses, and I support it in this way and in this way, in this way. This is a document that is so important, so useful, because it can tell us his narrative, but at the same time, we can read in the textual way how his interest expanded at that moment. The connection between these two merchants is indirect. They probably didn't know each other, but they had exchanges, and they have above all a network of contacts that were in the same level. I discovered in Madrid, in the Archivo Histórico de Madrid, a letter that is related also to the Inquisition file of Diego Hernández Victoria, a letter sent by João Dias, João Oliveira, sorry, that was the agent of Diego Hernández Victoria in China. And he is telling the story of a ship that wrecked in China, in the coast of China, with merchandises that they were planning to bring to the Manila Galleon. And in that letter, amazing. He relates several numbers of partners that are in different places, including the Spice Islands in Malacca, Macao, Japan, etc. This letter was is little known. Really, it was few historians pay attention to this letter, but it's like the key of contacts, is the directory of contacts of this merchant, and it's a letter to Hernández Victoria saying, we need to pay to such a person this amount, he lost all his silk, everything is spoiled, etc., but we can recover in this and this way. This is an internal private letter, but and is not, is overlooked, has been overlooked by many other researchers about this. There is a difference of time in certain way. While Báez Landero was more active in the 1580s, Hernández Victoria was more active in the 90s, although he probably came also from Macau and probably was active in Manila even before the 80s. But his big chance to become important in trade in Manila was with Governor Gómez Pérez das Mariñas and his son, Luis das Mariñas. And he had a very good relation with the governor, so much that the governor gave to Hernández Victoria the task to collect the money for the Manila wall that is constructed around the city. For the first time, Father Semedo was the designer and also they used the architect, an Spanish architect, etc. But this, it was Hernández Victoria that obtained first the role of the local authority for the administration of the city. And he had the specific role of collecting the money for the wall, a tax special tax that some of the priests criticized, etc. And the people looked at him, that he's a Portuguese, why he's doing this job? Well, because it was part of the role of, in a small community, and he was able to roll this task and to be very effective in his work. Probably there were no very strong personal contacts between these two heads of the network, but certainly the commercial objectives, certainly the patterns of trade, certainly the loyalties existed there, even there is not a document that can support specifically that they were their direct partners, but through different third persons. And I found this this number of 83 merchants, and I use network analysis in order to understand this type of connection. First of all, this is a distribution of the type of job that they had. Some openly merchants, but others had different tasks in life, or they were apparently no merchants, but all of them participate in trade. And the last essential role was precisely to contribute to the trade. We have people close to Hernández Victoria, like Juan Juárez Gallinato, was brother-in-law of Hernández Victoria. Hernández Victoria married María de Zárate, Spanish woman, apparently married her in Manila. Not uncommon, it's something that could happen quite well, but they had a son that was sent to Mexico. Hernández Victoria and María de Zárate, living in Manila, had contacts with all the elite, the small city of Manila. Juan Juárez Gallinato, the brother of María de Zárate, became quickly a military officer of high level responsibilities, even if he was very young. And it's not uncommon having different names, even being siblings, brother and sister. But this is part of the time. And Juan Juárez Gallinato has a light on himself because he became the military leader in the defense of Manila in different moments. He survived until the first decades of the 17th century. He was a military leader also invading Cambodia. Was a military leader, but not the one creating that adventure, because it was a failure. but he went to Cambodia and Laos and participated in those battles. Juan Juarez Gallinato became so famous on his own that even there are two novels, one play and one novel, forgotten, but it's an strange idea of a cavalier in Asia that defend the ladies, etc., etc. Another one that it was close to Hernández Vitoria is Esteban Rodríguez de Figueroa, Spaniard, military man, member of the crew of Legazpis in 1565. So in his long life, he became the possible successor of Gómez das Mariñas until it was a different order from Spain and he couldn't be the governor, but he was a landowner. Some of the part of the explorers, the company of Legazpi immediately received the benefit of land and indigenous people to work the land. And he was one of the richest persons in the place. More important, however, is that the Rodríguez Figueroa is a family in Spain that administer the tax office in Sevilla and the trade with the Americas. So the Rodríguez Figueroa appear in different places connecting trade in the Atlantic, in Mexico City, and in his case, in Manila. Diego Hernández Victoria had, among many other colleagues, two persons of very close that supported him in the business in New Spain. One is one priest, Francisco de Paz, probably Portuguese, probably Spanish, but living in Mexico, and he took care of his son, 9 years old. And there is a letter of Hernández Victoria asking Francisco de Paz to take care of his son and to sell some business in New Spain in order to create a funding to benefit his son. The other is Diego Caballero Bazán, that was part of the merchant group in New Spain. I will talk later on in a few more minutes about this. This question is how the different groups, jobs, in reality, all of them converge into trade. And the connections in network analysis, you need to connect the ontologies. Somebody sell to another person, send a letter, his brother off, etc. All of this is a type of connections that exist among the 83. Finally, the idea is to visualize the network. And you can see here how there are areas, there are dots that are bigger because it's the location. It can be Manila, Macao, Mexico City, Peru, and other cities, Acapulco, of course, and the different type of connections, more intense or less intense in terms of relationship. And network analysis try to search the centrality of certain participants in the network. This is the visualization of the network that allows us to figure out who is who, how they are central in the level of connections. The end of the story, but it's not the end of the story, is when part of the network, and Hernández Victoria in particular, was caught by the Inquisition, accused of being Jew in secretly practicing the law of Israel, and he was taken, but he died in the moment. He died in his home, in his bed. He wrote his will, and the Inquisition process took almost 10 years to simply conclude in the fact that he was not a Jew, but all his properties were on conflict, legal conflict, by the demand of the wife. That is amazing how certain letters of the wife criticizing the inquisitor as one bureaucrat unable to solve problems and only using his power to scare people, to frighten the good Christians like her. This is source enough for a novel, because she was able to face the Inquisition firmly and send letters everywhere in the world in order to defend his rights, her rights, and to collect the inheritance of the husband. So for the research, it was necessary to go to different archives in the world, in Mexico, in Spain, in different parts, and Portugal, of course, in which to me it was opening of the view of how extended was this network and how the origins of this type of networks came from long time. It's geographical pattern, but it's also cultural pattern that leave a trace from the north of Africa. People like Landeiro probably was educated in Portugal, but then after very young, participated in the slave trade in the north of Africa, finished in Cartagena de Indias, and make a career in Southeast Asia. We are talking about 16th century, not 21st century. The main pool of information is the Inquisition trials. Of the five implicated in this situation. And that means that it was necessary to be very careful to take with a pinch of salt the information in the different levels. And searching for connections, sometimes the opportunity to find a letter or a communication that connect different people was practically a question of luck. This group, this network, was badly affected by the taking Hernández Victoria, but it didn't disappear. We can find second and third generation of merchants of Portugal. Some connected, very few, but some new merchants coming into Manila in the 1620s, 1640s, and having similar patterns, very, very similar patterns, and even more successful than this generation, in which they continue connecting Asia and New Spain. So the idea of networks inside of a system was very helpful to understand the continuity and the possibility to break in certain moments. This is the learning part of this experience of research, that the documentation is quite evident to me, at least nowadays, and it goes a little bit deeper, one step ahead in this moment from other analyses that are or too local, too regional, only Southeast Asia, only New Spain, etc. But this is a first analysis in which it's connected New Spain and Asia. in this level of networks of merchants. Something that I want to, a bit of information that is relevant for the network. In New Spain, the network of Portuguese merchants were dedicated mostly to mining, silver mining. And they were also caught by the Inquisition at the end of the 16th century. And they were connected to the merchants in Manila, Portuguese. So it's a network that extended really globally and were highly sophisticated. Some of these members of the network in New Spain were also connected with the church, the Catholic Church, the Cathedral of Mexico, that it was the center of credit at that time in the new economy of New Spain at the end of the 16th century. Francisco de Paz and Diego Caballero Bazán were deeply connected with the church, so they were in the main areas of silver and credit. This is the other characteristic. Well, this is essentially the overview of the research, and I am open to your comments, questions. Thank you very much. Obrigado.
Thank you. Obrigado. Okay. It's the name of your blog, right?
Exactly. This is a commercial.
Okay. I will now stop share your.
Okay.
Muito bem. Muito obrigado. Thank you very much, Paul.
Yeah.
Okay, questions. Who wants to make the first one? Please. Podem levantar a mão ou podem agitar. Deixem cá ver. Muito bem. Okay, I have a small doubt.
Yeah.
Well, I have a small doubt a doubt and a small detail. The doubt is about that graphic with those figures on occupation. Mm-hmm. This was the Portuguese in Manila?
No, the network, the overall network across the Pacific. Yeah.
Okay. I only saw there 1.8% of priests. There were no missionaries.
No, I didn't find missionaries. Probably there were, but these priests were living and active in New Spain, and even they were criticized by the viceroy at that time, Villamanrique, that they were unfairly being traders, although they were priests, that it was supposedly forbidden, but they went all the way to Acapulco to collect the merchandise from Manila, being priests and connected to the Cathedral of Mexico. Totally illegal, but they were there.
The second is just a detail that you mentioned about the novels about Gallinato.
Novo Gallinato, Ovista, is a play that was published in the 17th century, in which they take the name of Gallinato, se llama Nuevo Gallinato, that is the second name of Juan Juárez Gallinato, and make this as a kind of hero in Southeast Asia, dominating the exotic kingdoms of Cambodia and Siam. And it was quite popular apparently in Spain and in America, this play.
Can you write in the chat box the name? It was two plays, two novels?
Yeah, I understand there were two. And became popular in precisely, I had that in the La Nova.
Republished in Spain in the 17th century?
Exactly, yes.
Okay, if you could please write in
I will.
In the chat box. Okay. Miguel, tens aí a manita levantada?
Yes, well, first of all, congratulations. And congratulations also on your book, which I just read a few weeks ago. So congratulations for that. I have a question regarding a section of your system, specifically the axis Manila, New Spain. You have emphasized the agency of the Portuguese New Christians there, which is something that historians have been doing, I think, since Boyajian, I believe. Which I think owes a great deal to the fact that we have a fair number of trial records existing on them. Since you studied the system as a whole, I was wondering if I could have your impression on what was the real expression of Portuguese new systems in that axis specifically vis-a-vis, for instance, the participation of other merchants, the Spaniards, of course, those who, not of new Christian origins, but also other Portuguese, not new Christians, but old Christians, since, of course, not every Portuguese that lives in Manila is necessarily new Christian. So I feel that there is an over emphasis on Portuguese new Christian merchants, owing to the fact that we have these trial records, such as Diego Hernández de Vitória, the Rodriguez brothers, even Antonio Dias de Cáceres, and so on. So I was wondering to have your opinion on that. Thank you.
Yes, you're right. The emphasis in my research was exactly on this identity of new Christians. However, doesn't eliminate or doesn't discard the existence of regular old Christians, Portuguese or even Spaniards, as in the case of the close circle of of the one in Macau, that signed Landeiro, because they signed a document, an affidavit, that is notarial document in which they were Capitán Mayor, de Malacca, traveling to Macau, and it was part of the team. So it was, regardless of the religion, they had contact with almost everybody. And this trust that is represented by affidavit and notarial document represent the highest point. It's like a contract, the highest point of trust in a network, because in the complexity theory, the trust, the way of working together at a distance, almost blindly, is an element that can break, but meanwhile, it works very well. When it breaks, it is a punishment. And in the case of this team that worked for more than 10 years together, apparently never happened this kind of break, of separation, break, or punishment to one of the participants. I don't know if the I'm using the concept to understand the behavior, the pattern of behavior of people of different, apparently different origin, in this case separated by the religion, but the trust was really strong in that sense. Yeah, the name of the author is Andrés de Claromonte.
We're talking about the author of the of Galinato's novels?
Yeah.
Andrés?
And I sent now.
Okay. Chat. Okay. Thank
and
you.
The piece is El Nuevo Rey de Gallinato and was written in 1604. As early as 1604, to show the European public about this story.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Muito bem. Mais questões e perguntas ou comentários? Elsa, se quiseres comentar alguma coisa, tu conheces bem esta área e conheces bem esta temática, não é?
Também? Sim. Eu peço desculpa. Paulo, podes fazer o favor de traduzir? Eu falo devagar.
Eu tenho.
Entende? Qual tem mal?
Sim. Okay.
Eu vou falar devagar. É só um contributo para a sua investigação, porque eu gostei imenso do livro, que tem a ver com o seguinte: quando Cuauhtémoc estabelece a ligação entre Diego Hernandes de Vitória, Diogo Fernandes de Vitória e Macau, pega na carta do João de Oliveira, que é uma carta que eu conheci a partir de si, e da tese do Miguel Lourenço. E se reparar nessa carta, a forma como o Diogo Fernandes de Vitória, o João de Oliveira se despede do Diogo Fernandes de Vitória, eu não sei, não tive tempo sequer de ir ver o documento outra vez, mas a ideia é esta, que nós que esperava que se voltassem a ver, não diz em Portugal, mas na nossa terra. Isso faz-me crer que, muito possivelmente, João de Oliveira era do Porto, da mesma forma, Cuauhtémoc, que o António Rebelo Bravo, que o Cuauhtémoc refere no seu livro, é do Porto, é de uma família proeminente do Porto, e tem uma estadia na Ásia desde 1510. É gente muito interessante.
São 1510? Rebelo ou João de Oliveira?
Não, António Rebelo Bravo, ok? Que é um parceiro do António Garcês de Miranda. E há aqui uma confusão, só este aspecto que eu vi por acaso, porque quis ver o fólio do processo do Diogo Fernandes de Vitória e pedi ao professor Rui Loureiro. Há dois António Garcês, que também têm raiz na cidade do Porto, Cuauhtémoc. Os Garcês são cristãos novos na cidade do Porto. Só que o Garcês de Malaca não é o mesmo Garcês de Macau, ok? O Garcês de Malaca, que vem no processo do Diogo Fernandes de Vitória, é António Garcês de Sequeira. Se for ao processo, ao fólio, verifica isso. Só que quem trabalhou antes de nós não confirmou ou pensava que o António Garcês de Macau era este homem e não é. São dois. São pessoas diferentes, está bem? Pronto, basicamente é isto que, para a reconstituição da rede, que me parece que é importante para si, na medida em que... confirma a leitura que o Cuauhtémoc fez. Basicamente era só isto que eu queria dizer. Depois, a minha posição em relação ao Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro é completamente diferente, mas eu levaria muito tempo a explicar e hoje não estou com o meu cérebro a funcionar 100%, mas o que eu fiz com o Temoc, e o Miguel Lourenço em particular conhece esse trabalho, e é um trabalho que eu nunca publiquei porque a tradução para inglês adulterou completamente o conteúdo do texto. Oh. Agora está a ser revisto novamente e eu vou entregar este ano, mas teve muito tempo estragado. Mas a minha perspectiva é completamente diferente e parte de uma pergunta que eu fiz relativamente justamente a essa forma de classificar o Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro como a pessoa mais importante de Macau, dito nas palavras do Sanchez, do jesuíta, como sendo o rei dos portugueses. Foi uma forma do Sanchez o apresentar face a Filipe II. Mas, na minha opinião humilíssima, pode ser que um dia caia, os mais importantes em Macau era justamente, ou o mais importante era justamente, António Rebelo Bravo. Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro dá o salto, não é? E arranja os seus próprios parceiros. Mas em Macau é outra gente que domina. Na minha opinião, ou no meu pensamento, Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro tentou uma outra via justamente para se impor a partir de Manila em Macau. Só que não surtiu efeito. Tá bem? Mas isto é a minha perspectiva, não quer dizer que seja a correta, foi a forma como eu vi, tá bem? Mas o mais importante agora e aquilo que eu queria transmitir é exatamente esta rede portuense que confirma a leitura que o Coalfem Mock fez. Mas são dois António Garcês, o do processo de Malaca é Sequeira e o de Macau é António Garcês de Miranda.
Correto.
Ok. Mas
muito obrigado. António Garcés aparece en el documento del affidavit, el documento notarial.
Ah, sim, E há um dado muito interessante. Eu peço desculpa, mas quando eu disse que estou com enxaqueca, eu não mentia. Eu estou mesmo com dor de cabeça.
Não, sim, sim.
Mas peço desculpa. É só para fazer rir. Mas o que eu lhe quero dizer é o seguinte. Agora, eu não tenho presente, muito bem presente, os termos em que, do seu livro. Mas há um aspecto interessante. Ah, tem a ver com o Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro e a sua estada no Sião. Pronto, isto é que é importante para si também.
Sim. Okay.
Então, o Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro, que o Qualtemoc refere o facto de ele, no Sião, ter combatido um pirata chinês. Pronto, é esse dado. Curiosamente, o António Garcês de Miranda, em 1580, também está no Sião. É muito interessante. É uma das carreiras que o António Garcês de Miranda faz, é Macau-Sião, e é, digamos, uma espécie de braço, não é? De sócio de um outro homem de Macau muito importante que morre em 1500, deve morrer por volta de 1580, porque o testamento é de 1580, que é um António Monteiro, que é compadre do António Rebelo Bravo.
Oh.
E muito importante, creio eu, para o seu trabalho, é o seguinte. É evidente que nós não podemos dizer que quando um mercador é compadre do outro, não é? Que não seja porque é padrinho dos filhos. Essa hipótese com o Pedro de Brito em relação ao Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro, que o Paulo Temoc coloca, é muito possível que seja real. Mas quando os mercadores portugueses se associavam, estabeleciam um vínculo familiar fictício, peço desculpa pela palavra, em que se autodenominavam de compadres. Por exemplo, no livro do Paulo Pinto sobre Malaca, aparece um comentário relativamente a um ouvidor em que ele estaria muito aparentado. É nesse sentido, está bem? Criam-se laços. São estrategicamente ligados para fazerem parcerias do ponto de vista comercial, está bem? Quando o Pedro de Brito é compadre do Bartolomeu Vaz Landeiro, também pode ser nesse sentido. E o António Rebelo Bravo, em 1580, é compadre desse António Monteiro, que curiosamente também é da cidade do Porto. O que eu quero transmitir ao Qualtemoc para a sua pesquisa futura é que a força da rede do Porto é muito grande em Macau. A cidade do Porto é muito grande em Macau. E o seu, porque é seu, Diogo Fernandes de Vitória, é da cidade do Porto, de certeza absoluta. Se for procurar registros de mercadores da cidade do Porto, encontra gente com este apelido Vitória. Também. Agora estou com uma branca em relação, esqueci-me do nome de uma... Ah, o apelido é Apolónia. É uma professora, não sei em que universidade está, mas que fez um trabalho sobre as elites mercantis do Porto, e este Vitória aparece lá, mas também, se precisar, eu dou-lhe a referência.
Sorry, just to say, it's possibly Amélia Polónia.
É Polónia, não é Polónia, é Polónia.
I will write the name in the chat box.
Sim, obrigada, obrigada, obrigada.
Thank you very, very much for this amount of information. I read precisely the work of Amélia Polónia in two volumes, actually. And then another text also from the Universidad Coimbra, no, Porto, from Porto, in which they say exactly, they describe the network in Porto, Porto, but I couldn't find the complete connection with Asia, just simply how binded, how connected they were exactly in Porto and many other places. But here the question was to locate the information that is in Southeast Asia, and then the last part of the analysis was the connection across the Pacific in the Manila Galleon. And is where I lost, let's say, the thread of the connection with Porto. That's why I left unconnected this other part. The intention was to establish certainty in the connections across the Pacific, in the Manila Galleon. Otherwise, we'll extend worldwide. And there is a possibility to extend worldwide, because also there were important connections in between Africa and Cartagena, and how some of these Portuguese arrived into New Spain and formed the group original in New Spain. The one that is connected to Cáceres, Antonio Díaz de Cáceres, because they came from the Atlantic, established in New Spain, and then after they connect with the Pacific. I was following the route from Southeast Asia to New Spain.
Okay.
Certainly, the network extended worldwide.
Okay, thank you. Há mais outras questões ou comentários? Nós estamos na... São 6:30, devemos acabar a sessão. Podemos estender durante mais 5, 10 minutos para final remarks, final comments. If no one has further comments, I have one... comment, not exactly a comment, something I would like to know what your opinion about. It doesn't mention exactly the Portuguese in Manila, But something that I've noticed regarding the Portuguese and the Spanish in Asia, when we mention and we talk about the Portuguese arrival in India and then in Asia, something that comes up immediately is the strategy, the informal strategy of partnerships with Asian trading communities. When the Portuguese arrived in Malacca, or the immediate partnership they established with the Hindu Kling, who had the knowledge, the know-how, the money, the ships for the Portuguese to just spread into the Asian networks. And then I think in Malacca it was evident, it was common. And that's why, for instance, we don't know exactly when the Portuguese arrived in Timor, because the Portuguese were mixed in the Asian trade networks. That's why we don't know if the Portuguese arrived in Australia or not in the 16th century, because if they were Portuguese, they were in Asian ships. They were not in a galleon with the flag of the King of Portugal. Well, but when I studied some aspects of the Spanish in the Philippines, I had some difficulty trying regarding similar strategies. For instance, in Manila, there are works and sources and lots of information, for instance, about the Chinese, the Sangles of Manila. And the Manila Acapulco galleon was connected with the Sangles who brought and works. And so was there no Spanish informal strategy of gathering and making partnerships with the Sangles or other Asian communities like the Portuguese did? Or did the Spanish follow a more a strict European Spanish strategy? Because I wasn't able to find similar informal strategies of small merchants trying to mix and make partnerships with Asian communities. Do you have any opinion on this?
Well, precisely the initial decision to occupy Manila, that in a way it was a hesitant strategy that started in Cebu, and after 5 years, they moved to Manila from 1565 to 1571. And the trade was not the main objective at that moment. In the following two decades, trade was starting to be important, but it was not the essence of the occupation of the archipelago. For the Spaniards, the occupation was a stronghold, a military presence in an area that it was extremely unknown, complex. And trade came as a second opportunity, second factor of actions. The occupation was essentially military from 1571 almost until 1590, the first four governors, and the missionary work was the second element, altogether with the military. Yeah. Slowly, the presence of merchants started to be more important at the end of the, near the 1600s, and certainly already in the 1700s. The discussions of 1593, previous to that, the discussions in Manila among the merchants indicate the name of Baslandero and Brito as part of the community of merchants, perfectly acceptable. The Spaniards were not reluctant of the presence of these Portuguese. And what made them vocal in the decision-making process was that they knew how it was the trading system in the region, and the connection with the Chinese, the connection with Southeast Asia, etc. They didn't have that dialogue with the Chinese. The Chinese were providers, suppliers of merchandise, and these kind of products start changing over time, because at the beginning, the Spaniards were demanding very basic things, from gunpowder, the elements for the gunpowder, nails, things to survive in Manila. Still not a trade that can be sent to America or Europe. It was not in the vision at that time. Almost two decades of trying to survive in the Philippines. Instead, Macau was already an emporium specialized on trade with China and in connection with even the Canton Fair. Already in the 70s, already they went back and forth, and they had the trade between China and Japan highly developed, already active and flourishing. Instead, the Spaniards were not dedicated full time to trade at that time. The main question was to survive in the place. I think this is a reason to understand why they accepted the input of the Portuguese. Finally, they were not enemies, competitors in a way, but the competitors in a very abstract way, don't cross the line of the Tordesillas, the division, don't enter into our domains, etc. But Manila was a matter of fact in which the Spaniards were dominating. Either it was the space of the Portuguese, the debate slowly faded out. It was a matter of fact that they were already in the Philippines, and the Portuguese were observing the opportunities. I don't say, and I wrote in the text that this group that I analyzed in such a particular way, put the magnifier in this group, doesn't mean that it was the only group active in trade. On the contrary, the Chinese became so important that in one point they were overwhelming for the Spaniards, and there were so many tensions that led to the assassination of many Chinese at the beginning of the 17th century, to that level of conflict. But certainly they were not the only inputs in the Manila Gallery.
Ok. Thank you. Uhum. Ok, questões? Há mais algum comentário ou alguma questão? Não havendo. Muito obrigado a todos. Obrigado ao Kuau, Tamok, Villamar, foi o nosso convidado especial de hoje, e aos presentes. Isto, estamos em julho, estamos à porta, já depois ao fim de um longo ano. Portanto, enfim, é preciso fazer algum esforço final. Eu vou agora interromper a gravação. Eu, como disse, isto está a ser gravado, depois ficará disponibilizado no canal do YouTube do CHAM.
Muito bem.
Portanto, em nome do CHAM e em nome da linha temática, muito obrigado a todos.